Good evening, and welcome to the FAAA Lecture Series. The FAAA Lecture Series is organized by the Faculty of Architecture Alumni Association at CEPT University. This year's lecture series is made possible through the generous support from Symphony Limited. FAAA would like to thank the alumni and friends of Faculty of Architecture, CEPT University, for their support. To know more about the lecture series and about FAAA, you can visit our website at www.faaa.org.in. Before we begin, may I request you to silence your mobile phones and minimize the going in and out of the auditorium while the lecture is on. Today's lecture is by Ireena Vittal on India's Urban Story 2015, the case for urbanization. Ireena Vittal is an acclaimed consultant on emerging markets, agriculture, and urban development. She was a partner at McKinsey & Company, where she worked for over 16 years and was a founding member of the Economic Development Practice and the Global Emerging Markets Practice. Ms. Vittal has published several reports, including How Half the World Shops, The Great Indian Bazaar, and Building a Billion-Dollar Business in India and China. She has co-authored the McKinsey Global Institute report on Indian urbanization, India's Urban Awakening, Building Inclusive Cities, Sustaining Economic Growth. Also the first integrated report on Indian agriculture and on building rural infrastructure and services. Ireena Vittal serves as senior advisor at Aspada Investment Advisors. She is currently on the board of leading Indian corporations, including Titan Industries, Axis Bank, Wipro, Indian Hotels, Godrej Consumer Products, and Tata Global Beverages. Ms. Vittal holds a postgraduate diploma in business management from IIM Calcutta and a BSc in electronics from Osmania University. Please welcome Ireena Vittal.
Thank you guys for being here on a Friday evening. It's an honor and a privilege to be here. What I'm going to do is take you through my version of the India story. And I've called it the India Urbanization Story Acknowledged and What's Next. There are many lenses to look at urbanization and indeed to look at cities. There is obviously a political lens. The story is not the political version of Indian stories. There's also a social lens on what we do with citizenship, how do cities help communities live with each other. Unfortunately, this story is also not about the social lens of cities. It is very much an economic lens. So look at it in the context of cities being increasingly acknowledged as engines of growth. And while the other elements of politics and society will come in, they won't be the central theme of the story today. But I wanted to talk to you a little bit about the lessons that I've learned over the last 7-8 years of exploring this mammoth ocean. And the first thing that struck us a long time ago was India is a very reluctant urbanizer. For the longest time, we didn't acknowledge cities to be important. We were caught in the mythology of Mahatma Gandhi said India lives in her villages. And so for the longest time, we did not acknowledge it even in our constitution. And it took many, many decades after independence to say cities matter. But the journey is inevitable because citizens move. And citizens move to cities not because cities are esoteric, but because cities are aspirational. And a lot of them are related to jobs, and a lot of them are related to development. So the journey is inevitable. The question is the pace at which India will make this journey and whether it will be a proactive choice or whether we will reactively handle what big cities will do to how our citizens live and to how our economy grows. Cities are clearly important to India's future. And many, many years ago when we did the McKinsey report, we had to build a case for urbanization with politicians and with bureaucrats because it was not obvious to many amongst them why should India even be thoughtful about how we build our cities. And so the way we build our case using facts is what I'm going to share with you for the next couple of minutes. And the first piece was very critical, which was, you know, a lot of our population actually sits in our cities. It's surprising to see that a economy as large as this and a country as large as India in terms of population is only 30% urbanized. But it's also because the definition of urbanization that India has, three-part definition that you guys are perhaps familiar with, is one of the most restrictive in the world. And you relax some of those laws, and some people would tell you that India is actually 52% urbanized today. So one doesn't really know. From a formal definition, India is 30% urbanized. It'll be 40% urbanized by 2030. And 2030 is just a cutoff. It has no meaning beyond that. But if you relax and look at urbanization in the form of including census towns, then India could almost be half urbanized even today. But even if you go with the formal definition, we're going to add 250 million people to urban India in the next 15 years. And from a GDP point of view, given the mix of productivity, India already accounts for 60% of the GDP, and it will continue to grow important. So from a economy point of view, from a citizen point of view, maybe one day from a voting point of view, cities are clearly important for India's future. It's also important because for a country as young as India, we need jobs. And just because of the mix of the economy, 70% of the new jobs will be created in cities. It doesn't mean rural India will not create jobs. It just means that rural India should take people out of back-breaking agriculture, like every other economy has. And even if you look at the 70% of Indians employed in rural India, only about 35% today are employed in farming. The rest of them are employed in non-farming. So that journey has also started. And so while rural India will create more jobs, urban India will create even more jobs. And more importantly, there will be higher productivity given the urban mix. And so while rural India will see incomes improve, you will see a 4x growth in income in urban India. So you put all of this together for a very young country, which is looking for more jobs, which at the end of all of this noise is still $2,000 per capita, and you realize why cities as engines of growth are an important imperative for our country. But if you looked at 2030 and you took a snapshot of India, you will also see the importance of this from a slightly different angle. Five of the biggest states of India, and economically important states, will be more than 50% urbanized by 2030. So this false choice of rural versus urban will no longer be relevant. You will have urban Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Maharashtra, Gujarat, of course, and also Punjab. In fact, Tamil Nadu is almost this number even today. 68 cities will have a population of more than 1 million. And just to place this in context, all of Europe has 35 cities which more than 1 million of population. So if you look at the landscape of big cities in the world, a large number of them will be from China, India, and then Nigeria. And also, some of the top cities will be countries in the making. If you look at the GDP of Bombay or Delhi or Calcutta, in 2030, it will be the size of Malaysia's GDP today. If you look at the population, or if you look at the GDP of Bangalore or Ahmedabad or Hyderabad, it will be 2 to 4 times the size of Mumbai. So the mental map we have of our cities, which is, you know, a city run by a good IS officer, two guys who clean the streets and three plumbers, is all mythology. Think of Bombay, it'll be the size of Malaysia, and think of how we think of running our cities. So the mental models that we have of cities will need to fundamentally change, because the density of population and the shape of India's urbanization will throw up challenges which are quite unprecedented. And the numbers, resulting numbers, will be huge. 590 million people will live in cities, which will be almost 2 times the size of the US population today. 270 million people will enter the working age population. A lot of them will get jobs in urban India. A Chicago will be built every year, even if you assume India grows at 5 to 6% GDP and has the commensurate construction activity associated with it. We haven't even done the crazy construction intensity of China, but a Chicago will get built every year, and we're going to build more metros and subways in the next 15 years than we have 20 times of what we've added in the last decade. So the scale of urbanization is quite unprecedented. Even though we have not made urbanization central to our story the way China did from 1990. But if you look at the starting position which all of us know is quite grim. And you and I feel it as citizens every day, right? Water supply is limited, 30% of sewage is treated, 24% of urban population is in slums. And if you go to the big cities, with the exception of Bangalore, this is between 50 and 60%. Public transportation share has dramatically declined. Stormwater drains only for 20%, and so on and so forth. So our starting position is not a particularly heartening one. And it'll get worse because of the flow of of citizens into our cities. So every one of these services, whether it's water supply or sewage or transportation, you're going to see a 4 to 5 times increase in the next 15 years. If you look at affordable housing, we will need 44 million units. Our cumulative stock today is only a small fraction of it. And this is true for education, it's true for healthcare, it's true for power, it's true for everything. On the one side, this means a lot of billionaires will be created, because a lot of this is going to be created in a public-private opportunity worldwide, including in China. The first richest woman of China was somebody who handled garbage and garbage handling. So this is also a great opportunity for the next generation of entrepreneurs. And don't forget, India is a country of entrepreneurs. It works despite the government. So this is an opportunity. But on the other hand, if the policy framework does not recognize this and doesn't get fixed, the trajectory could lead to urban decay, very much like some of the countries in Latin America have seen. So one of the objectives of our whole approach when we were framing the urbanization story was to shake up the political system and also tell them, hey, this is both a great opportunity, but mishandled, it would also underwrite and basically put your economic story at risk. A lot of the growth that India has seen between 91 and 2010 was built on the crucible of the infrastructure that had historically existed. But that infrastructure now has run out of marginal return. And so for the next 15 to 20 years, we do need as a nation to reinvest in infrastructure almost at a Herculean pace. Otherwise, the 6 to 8 to 9% GDP growth rate, which is the story of India, is hugely at risk. And that was the story that we were trying to tell, not so much to scare off all of us away to run away and live in Singapore. But we all know that it's fixable. It's fixable because other countries have done it. This is a photograph of Shenzhen before 20 years and after, and of course Singapore. So it's possible to do this. And if countries like China, and you might not like the shape in which China has done it, but they've done a reasonable job, have done it at the pace that India will perhaps follow, maybe at level of 50%, the question that we asked ourselves is, what would it take to fix India's urban issues going forward? And there were lessons, which I won't take you through, that we learned from all cities that have urbanized, but I brought it down to you in the form of a new operating model. Now, I come from the business world, so my language is that of a business person, but this is how we thought of it, right? Which is, we need a new way of building and having our cities live and breathe. The first one of this is actually, let's get the big issue out of the way. The first one of this is funding. It's clear that we have under-invested in our cities. If you look at the per capita spend on capital expenditure that other countries have done per year per citizen, the UK spends about $391. China has spent $116. We spend about $17. And the $17 is a mix. So you have about $80 in Bombay, you have $3 in Panvel, and you have zero in a small town outside Raipur, right? I mean, if you look at small municipalities, they literally have no budgets. And whatever little budgets they have, it goes to pay for the salaries of the 3 or 4 people that are employed. So we have really underinvested in our cities. And think of you running your own homes. If you don't do the bare minimum that is required to build a home or to maintain it, it goes to seed, and the cities are nothing but the same. So one of the big challenges for India is, how much of capital expenditure do we need? And we spent a lot of time scrubbing these numbers, but if you took physical and social infrastructure and you took transportation, we need about $1.2 trillion of capital funding in the next 20 years. Does anybody know what the GDP of India is today? What's the size of the Indian economy today? Say it. It's $2 trillion. Right? So we're talking of $1.2 trillion being invested when the size of the Indian economy is $2 trillion. So this is not insignificant amount of money. We're talking of almost $60, $70 billion a year. But it's not just what we need in capital expenditure, because you know, if you put up water pipes, they need to be managed and maintained. We need an additional $1 trillion in terms of operating expenditure. So we need about $2.3 trillion in the next 20 years for a country whose GDP is $2 trillion. Now, as an economist, this makes your heart burst with joy, because it basically means you have a 1 to 2% increase in your GDP, which will come from investment in our cities. The same thing happened in China. If you look at China's 10% GDP growth rate, I don't know if you follow it, but they have something called the gross capital formation, which is the investment rate in the economy. And that's about 48 to 50%, which means they invest back in their economy 48 to 50% of the size of the economy every year for the last 20 years. And a huge amount of it has been infrastructure. So almost 1 to 2% of the China GDP growth rate comes from city building. And this could mean the same thing for us. India spends about 34 to 36% of GCF. We need to increase that to at least 40-44. And a lot of the new capital formation, a lot of the new investment could come in what we do in our cities. So from an economics point of view, this is not a huge number, and it's actually great news. Now, how would you fund this, right? And the good news for India is there are four key funding sources that all cities across the world use. Land monetization is one of them. And India and Indian government sits on crazy amounts of land. They don't know where it is. They don't have land registers. But they do own a lot of land. Property tax and user charges is another big source of funding, as is debt. I don't know if you guys know, but when Detroit went bankrupt, it's because Detroit as a city had a balance sheet. And they borrowed too much of money and couldn't pay it back, so it went bankrupt. Now, none of the Indian cities have a balance sheet. So Indian cities have zero loans, right? And we've just launched in this year's budget something called the municipal bond, the Muni bond, which is the start of cities being able to fund themselves. So India has zero debt in the books of her 7,000 plus cities. And of course, support from the government. Big cities like Bangalore, big cities like Bombay, earn enough in the form of taxes to support, to put back into the cities. But smaller cities everywhere in the world need grants, and they need a logic for it. And that is also, we have enough money in the center to be able to spare money for our cities. Now, the good news is India can leverage all of this, both on capital expenditure and on operating expenditure. All of these are levers that are virgin levers. We haven't really used them. And so funding is not an issue. And in a few places, whether it's MMRDA in Bombay, there are examples of having done this, when transparent land monetization helped raise almost 22 billion in that small parcel of land, which is why BKC was created. And Bandra Kurla Complex, for those of you who know Bombay, is now the new central business district, while Nariman Point is going to seed. So it's possible to do this even in India. So what was clear when it came to rejuvenating our cities was, while the funding need was huge, we could fund all of our cities. The real issue was, could each of our cities understand how much of assets they're sitting on? Could they get a land bank register? Could they know who the citizens are and find a way to meter their water and meter their power and then find a way to collect taxes? Could they find a way to actually have accountants and auditors inside the city municipal commission so that they could draw up a P&L and draw up a balance sheet? And you'd be surprised to know that most of our cities don't draw balance sheets, don't draw P&Ls. We run our cities pretty much like our mothers run our homes, you know, seat of the pant. There are only two or three cities in India which have started to create their own balance sheets and P&L. And finally, can the central government, the state government, and the city governments find an equation by which grant making can be automatic, linked to number of citizens, rather than linked to political effort? So the good news is funding is, while there is a huge amount of money required, it's all possible to get. The issue is, can we implement the approach to be able to do it systematically? The interesting issue, and to me, in many ways, the fundamental issue of at least starting on the new journey is governance. Who will lead and be accountable for our cities? We have five challenges here. The first one of them is structure. We treat all our cities the same way, whether it's Bombay or Delhi now, which is part of NCR, or whether it is Panvel, or whether it is a small city in the middle of Gujarat. While you know and I know that metropolitan structures are very different from big cities, which are very different from small cities. And so for the first thing I think we need to do is we need to decide that 20 cities are actually metropolitan municipal structures. And the biggest implication of this will be in who takes decisions on integrated transportation. Because in a metropolitan structure, some decisions are not taken at the city level, they're taken at the metro level. Equally importantly will be some kind of a decision on mayors. Who will run our cities? India is one of the very few countries in the world who has no elected executives for cities. Now, the important thing here is not elected. The important thing here is an accountable person to run our cities, and preferably a political person to run our cities. Because if you think of what a city is a series of choices that you make for the long term, which will always place one set of citizens priorities over the other set of citizens' priorities. So if you really want to govern a city well, you have to create a vision, a common vision of what you want the city to be. You have to translate that into a series of initiatives that need to be taken. And more importantly, you need to then align various interest groups to be able to prioritize so that you can do capital allocation well. This is not the job of a manager. This is actually the job of a political representative. So the real issue for Indian cities is, even when you have a really good IAS officer as the municipal commissioner, his tenure at best is 1 to 2 years, right? And assuming he's not corrupt and assuming he's interested in this business, he will do whatever he's capable of doing in 1 to 2 years. And what that usually ends up being is water and roads. There is very little incentive and very little alignment that he can bring on big decisions, which are to do with redevelopment of parts of the city, which is to do with integrated planning on transportation, which is in some cases to revisit some of the fundamental policies. So the second big governance decision in this country is how do we get elected executives, or at least executives, to work in cities. There is a model which funnily enough kind of works in Calcutta, where you have an elected body that represents the MPC, and then you have a metropolitan authority, and this mayor-commissioner model works quite well. They had replicated it in Chennai. It worked very well till the DMK government decided to dismantle it. So there are models to make it work. But the core issue here is at some point in time, like we have a central ministry run by the Prime Minister, the state ministry run by the chief minister, and by the way, the villages run by sarpanches, the intermediate structure of cities needs to be run by somebody who has the voice of the citizens. And that's the second big issue in governance. The third one is accountability. You have no point in talking about accountability till you have a neck to catch. But if you had somebody who was accountable, you would then create accounts so that you would know what money flowed in and what money flowed out. You would have right pricing. It might be through regulators who set prices, because it's very difficult for politicians to increase prices of water and power. But if you have regulators, you can do it, like you see in some other sectors. And you need to have e-governance, e-ways of automating. There are examples of this already working. Bangalore went to a e-collection mechanism for property taxes, and they've seen their property tax collection go up 7 times. Surat has been experimenting with some of this. So there are, it's not as if we don't have examples of this, but we need this to become much more systematic across all of our cities. We also need to have reliable agencies. No government can deliver public services at any scale. Forget about the scale of India. And what you see most cities end up doing is they create agency systems to be able to deliver power or water in some cases, education, in some cases, hospital network. The important thing is to corporatize it. You don't have to privatize it. And there are examples of this, for example, BEST. BEST in Bombay, which runs the whole transportation system, does a fantastic job. You always have buses on time. You have the train system on track. But it's not run by a government department. It's run by an agency. So we need to have agency structures created with their own balance sheet and their own accountability. And finally, talent. Our cities have absolutely no talent. We literally run them with 3 or 4 people, and these are complex systems. And what you really need in a city is you need norms, first of all, for city staffing. The government has been working on it for some time. You need technical experts. Think about creating an integrated transportation model for our cities. How do you do that if you don't have technical expertise? And it's unlikely that you will get this at a city level, but you need to get it at least the state level, if not at the central level. You need to outsource. A whole bunch of standard functions in our cities can be outsourced, as they are in many cities across the world. By the way, I don't know if you guys know, but the postal system in India, in the villages, was outsourced right from the point it was started. The local postmaster also did delivery. So we have examples of it even in our own country. And we need to do the same thing for functions such as finance or functions such as HR or anything that is outsourceable. We will create a municipal cadre. And finally, we need to allow our cities to be able to hire beyond employment exchanges. I don't know if you know, but if cities need to hire people, they can only go to employment exchanges. And since employment exchanges in India are completely defunct, it's a circular logic. They're never able to hire people. So we need to think about how we will populate our municipal governments to be able to run our cities. In the process, you will create almost 3 to 4 million jobs in terms of running our cities. And you can see that in your private complexes where you guys live, how many people are required to run small homes. The same thing will be replicated 1,000, 2,000 times in our cities. So the second big theme was about governance. The third lever that we need to change on, which I'm not going to spend too much time on since you guys are the gurus on this, is planning. We don't plan. We plan for projects. We don't plan for cities. And like elsewhere in the world, we need to think about concept plans and master plans and spatial plans and all of that stuff, starting perhaps with an economic plan so that there is clarity on why should somebody come and invest in the city. The biggest fight, the first fight that I think is going to help cities function well is the fight between states to attract investment. And this fight, which is already visible, right? You have vibrant Gujarat and now you have vibrant Maharashtra and somebody else is doing vibrant Madhya Pradesh, will go down to the city level. And the moment that happens, cities will need economic plans. They will need a proposition to attract investors. And the moment that happens, they're clarifying what kind of jobs they want. And once that happens, it basically will decide the quality of life that they want to offer their citizens. So there is, in a funny way, this might come because of the urgency to attract investment, but there is a need to do integrated planning for jobs, for space, for inclusion, and that's a huge area, including changing some of our stupid norms on FAR and FSI and all the other stuff on planning that you guys know. So I'm not going to spend too much time on planning, but we really need to think about how our cities make and enforce land use and transportation choices, because at the heart of it, for sustaining a livable city, you need smarter planning. The fourth thing, which I'm going to go through quickly, is sector policies. We need sector policies around economics. We need sector policies around affordable housing so that as our cities grow, there is place inside our cities next to where the jobs are for the people who can't afford housing. And there has been a huge discussion in India around affordable housing. And the biggest shift that we've been pushing here is to say it's really around two things. One is we need affordable housing inside cities. We don't need affordable housing outskirts or outside because the jobs are inside cities. And so we're thinking we need to rejuvenate the old model of mixed living. And the second thing is we need to think of rental. Affordable housing is not about buying. Affordable housing is about rental housing. Whether it's Singapore with 85% public housing, whether it's the UK, London, whether it's New York, all cities have rental housing. And so it's about constructing homes, but it's also about finding a mechanism to keep them, renovate them, and more importantly, finding a mechanism to make sure that they're allocated in some kind of an equitable model. So there is a huge big thing on affordable housing to make India slum-free and to prevent the smaller cities actually from becoming slummed up going forward. And then given that we came late to this party, one of the advantages of being late to a party is you can leapfrog. So as we are building our cities, as we are starting on our CapEx and OpEx game, it's very sensible to think about sustainability and climate change mitigation now, because we don't have to do retrofitting. We can actually leapfrog to technologies which are cutting edge because we are so late to this party. So I could go on, there's a whole bunch of other sector policies, but there is a need for some kind of alignment at the central level on what kind of policies do we want to have to enable our cities to be developed in a certain manner. And the last point that you see in the middle, other than funding, governance, planning, and sector policies, is shape. Shape is really about how do we want our country's population to be distributed. Different countries have ended up with different shapes. I don't think it was really thought through, with the exception of China. So if you look at Germany is a series of small towns because the German economic system is very distributed. And if you look at where their center of gravity economically is, because SMEs are so important, it's quite distributed. So you don't really have the equivalent of a Shanghai or a Beijing. If you look at the US has a very different shape, which has evolved along the East Coast, along the West Coast, with very huge amounts of fragmentation. More importantly, given that they have crazy amounts of land and much less density than we ever will, their shape, even within states, has been suburbanization. One of the big debates for India is what should the shape of India's urbanization be? Now, there are certain norms that will define this. Given that we have 30 cities and we are democratic, it's unlikely that you're going to squirrel away Bombay, Delhi in the top 8 cities and say, let's fix them first. You are going to be a lot more equitable. And I think the way the current government's policy is evolving, that is perhaps the way in which India's shape will evolve, which is we will have to rejuvenate the top 400, 500 cities. They are too big to ignore, and they're too big to fail. We will have to take care of the smaller cities, 700, 800 of them. There are over 4,000 of them. And make sure that the ones which are becoming reasonable in size don't get to the bad shape that the big cities are. So we will need a special plan for the next tier of towns. We will have to take care of specialist towns, which are disproportionately skewed in terms of either the economic center of gravity or because they're heritage towns or because they are along coasts. But we have specialist towns which have a very different rhythm and a cadence to them, and they will need a special treatment. And then we'll have to really think about green adjacencies or green towns, new towns, which actually cannot be in the middle of nowhere, right? They will be suburbanization of large towns. Bangalore, for example, for those of you who follow it, tripled in size one day because the municipality of Bangalore redrew the map, right? And you suddenly have, but if you look at the way Bangalore runs itself, two-thirds of its capital allocation and two-thirds of its 20,000 people or 18,000 people in the municipality still service one-third of the original Bangalore. So while the shape of Bangalore has changed, the capital allocation and the people allocation of Bangalore is still stuck in the past. So the shape debate is really about coming back from a very corporate point of view. At the heart of this whole debate will be capital allocation. Where will you spend your money and how will you prioritize? And there we had a huge big debate with the government on how do you want the shape of India's population to be. So that was really the new operating model. And if you think about it, none of this is dramatic. None of this is new. A lot of it has early signs of proof of concept within India, definitely in Asia. We're not even expecting this to move the China way, which was top-down urbanization and land use the way you want, and political party-driven. We're talking of something that could work within the ethos of the Indian democratic system. The real issue is actually, like in most cases in India, one of implementation. And how do you get this done when the design of a lot of this is in Delhi, but the implementation of a lot of this is at the state level and actually at the city level? And the start of this was really perhaps JNNURM. After the 74th Amendment, nothing really happened till JNNURM was created. And JNNURM, for those of you who know it, disbursed almost $13.3 billion, a hell of a lot of money. And over 2,500 projects were approved. But please note, these were projects, right? These were not integrated plans to rejuvenate Ahmedabad. It was BRTS in Ahmedabad, or it was the JNNURM buses that you got. The core of the densification stuff that you're doing in Ahmedabad is only now starting to happen. So while the design of JNNURM was urban renewal mission, it ended up being a funding project for 2,500 projects. And somewhere along the way, the magic of renewal got dropped. And so the hope is that going forward, as JNNURM gets reclassified, perhaps as Deen Bandhu Dayal something urban renewal mission, it will go back to renewal and not to project-based funding. And the start is not necessarily new projects, but clarity in many ways. To me, the heart of this will be if we can have a political solution on who runs the city. And since there was so much of debate on what SMART meant, I was pushing the government to say that, you know, SMART actually means governance, right? So S is for structure, mayor, accountability, reliable service and talent. And quite frankly, this is a stroke of pen decision. This does not require anything dramatic. It just requires two things to happen. Local state politicians to be comfortable with creating potential competitors at the city level. The enlightened ones amongst them will see this as a way of building a political cadre. If a local party in Delhi could win by going down to the area sabha and mohalla levels and telling them, we understand you, the same thing could happen in 200 cities in India. And where would that leave the big political parties? So the hope, the real hope of AAP might actually be getting the big political parties to realize that cities could be the crucibles for connection with voters. Cities could also, over time, be the crucibles for creating leaders of tomorrow. It's fascinating for me that the Communist Party in China has got it. And if you look at the career paths of their people, while they might start solving for Tibet and, you know, the back-end waters of Xinjiang, the third most powerful person in China is the mayor of Shanghai. So in the last 20 years, the Chinese party has legitimized mayoral roles by making it part of the career path. The current prime minister of Italy was the mayor of Florence. The current president of Indonesia was a mayor, right? Maybe one day the Boris of London will challenge the Conservative Party leadership. So there are signs of this which have happened in our backyard, but I'm hoping that political parties will embrace city leadership as part of their political cadre. And that's one thing that needs to happen, because it's really a political challenge within parties to be able to create this role. It's happened, by the way, with sarpanches in villages. We hope it will happen with cities. And the other piece to make this happen is actually removing the opacity on land. A lot of the land rents at the city level, because they are given plot by plot, help political parties to run their books. And so if there is transparency bought on land and land sale, then the reason to keep opacity in urbanization and in the way we run our cities will go down. So in many ways, I'm going to stop here and say, beyond governance, what we really need is a new vocabulary and design solutions, where you guys come in. We need to create, we need to tell, even if you have a wonderful politician who comes up as mayor or a really good bureaucrat who's given 5 years to run Ahmedabad, what would he do Monday morning, right? In the absence of knowing anything better, he will look for three projects, and there will be two flyovers and one MRTS system and one road, because that's what he knows. That's what he thinks is equivalent to city rejuvenation. And maybe in a couple of years, we will have a language or we'll have a checklist for our city leaders which says, you want to really fix the city, start with a blueprint, which means start with an economic plan, which is linked to population and job mix, prioritize what you want to do, make sure you have policies to attract talent and investors, and make sure you have norms for quality of life, because this is what actually defines everything else that you do in cities. Then create master plans, and the master plans will evolve, but like Eisenhower said, plans are not important, the process of planning is. And in the process of planning, you align people. And in the process of planning, you make people feel included. You don't have to agree, but you involve them in the process. And then you do what is priority for a city. And then finally, we need to get state governments and cities to get credit ratings to raise funds. And the last point is align citizens through local involvement and participation, both rights and responsibilities. Strengthen capacity, maybe in the short term by getting the private sector, and crafting the right PPP model. So this is my story of Indian cities. Its time is here because citizens are moving to cities. It's important because the whole India story of GDP growth is linked to cities as engines of growth. The challenge is really one of revisiting how we will run our big cities. We can't run them in the old way anymore. And the elements of it are not dramatic. They're really how to fund, how to plan, how to govern, how to have sensible policies, and how to allocate funds within a state and within a city. And the starting point, for me at least, is getting clarity on who will take this decision on behalf of a city. It cannot be an IAS officer always. And once we've done that, it's really about creating a new vocabulary. And that's where I hope people like you will play a critical role. Thank you.
Hi, thank you for the lecture. My question might seem a bit naive because I don't belong to the planning or the urban design background. But when you spoke about the shape of the cities, what sort of got me thinking was we're looking at the cities being urbanized and then increasing the number of cities. It's probably not related to your presentation, but I was just thinking, do you think or is there a possibility when you see that maybe some of these cities, because of fail and maybe implementation of different policies, might lead to any of the Indian cities becoming ghost towns due to failure of economic activities or some sort of a attraction to some other place and sort of abandoning the cities because something has probably gone wrong somewhere?
We haven't seen that, and a lot of it is to do with the structure of economics in this country. If you look at the structure of our economy, almost 60% of our GDP comes from consumption, right? And if you look at the other side of structure, if you don't look at it from a consumption expenditure side, if you look at it from a mixed point of view, almost 70% of our jobs are with self-employed people. So you would see destruction, ghost cities, Detroit, for example, being at risk because it is so centralized and focused on one particular sector. Because this country is consumption-led and it's MSME-led, we haven't seen ghost towns till now because you still have services happening. And don't forget, 60% of the economy is also service-led, so we haven't seen that. But in our definition, and it was a outsider's definition of shape, shape really had three parts to us. One was, I don't know if you know, but less than 1% of India's land mass is dedicated to her cities. So the question was, how much of India's landmass will go towards cities? So if you think about the map of Gujarat 30 years later, how much more of the map will be cities and how much of it will remain common or agri or rural areas? So that was one decision, right? And if you do the math, you still end up having 4 to 5% of the country, not more than that. The second one was within cities, if you think of the shape of a city, do you see it as a suburban to central model where people will drive or like in London, go in public transport? Or do you see cities as contiguous clusters with centralized, with economic activity that is self-contained? And our hypothesis was India will be more of the second rather than central business district with huge amounts of traffic flowing in, just given our density. And the third one, which was even more esoteric, was the community, the implication of the multicultural, multi-religious, active, dense population that we have. What does that mean for shape? Because you decide the flows of people when you decide height and how much of green space you give, right? So that was the third definition of shape, saying, wouldn't it be lovely if we didn't assume that every city in India would be series of towers standing next to each other where people waved out when they were getting into buses or into cars? So our shape conversation, because it's so early in the game, was not about, was much more forward-looking. It didn't assume ghost cities. I can't see that happening. And I think the government realizes that, which is why they are in the process of revisiting what should be the PPP approach, right? If you look at, for example, if you look at the cities which are trying to do something on water, you quickly realize two or three things, right? Which is you don't have an aligned government department working with the private sector, right? Second, you don't have clarity on what to bid because there are absolutely no numbers, right? So you end up taking the risk. And you end up taking the risk one way or the other, right? And third, from an execution point of view, the moment right of way enters, your timeline goes for a toss. So what ends up happening is you have a disproportionate share of risk being transferred to a private party with no way of managing it. He can't hedge it in any way. So I think one of the things that the government is thinking of is, can you give a turnkey project where this has been de-risked to some extent. Now, what that means is still to be debated, but Bajor, your alumni in the World Bank, is helping them revisit what PPP looks like. But clearly, right now, the PPP model is more on paper. It does not take into account operational risks that the private sector ends up with. If they could address that, there are so many people who are waiting to get into each of these businesses because these are big sectors and these are very profitable sectors worldwide. It's a win-win. You know?
You mentioned affordable housing and slums. Do you see affordable housing as the as a solution to, for both you mentioned growing cities that need to be guided, do you see affordable housing as a solution to the slums? And the second part, what do you think about the existing slums on how to transform those from an urban point of view?
So, yes, I mean, I think we will need affordable housing in all our cities because it's not, the citizens don't have the cost to income ratio, whatever, right? I mean, you're always going to have between 40 and 60% of the citizens, at least for the next 20, 30 years, who won't be able to afford a house, even if it's the smallest 400, 500 square feet houses. So you will need affordable housing, but you will need affordable housing as a rental stock, not necessarily as built cheap and then sold, because what then ends up happening is there's an arbitrage or a rich person buys it and it goes into a toss. So the real affordable housing that you need is inside cities as rental stock and made along, it's almost a responsibility of somebody who's building something that is for the marketplace to support, you know, the families that are required. So yes, it's a part of every single city of ours, and I think it will be true 100 years later. Nothing will change. Now, the fascinating thing about India is we had this. If you go and look at the mill lands in Bombay, they all had affordable housing, right? The mill land owners 100 years ago, what we call as chawls, was nothing but affordable housing. If you look at the industrial cities in India, they all had this concept of, if when workers come, where on earth will they live? And so owners took the responsibility of building affordable houses. We kind of forgot it for some reason after independence. So we need it. On slums, the good news about slums, I mean, not that there's too much of good news, but the good news about slums is it's much bigger of a problem in the bigger towns today. But if it continues in the same way, then by 2030, half of our slum population, and it'll be a huge number, will actually be in tier two, tier three towns. So right now, tier two, tier three towns are better off, but in another 15 years, if we continue on the same trajectory, we might not have 60% of citizens living in slum like we have in Bombay, but we'll have a reasonable number. The solution to that is the policy that they have, for example, in Bombay is a sensible policy. The issue is in the implementation of the policy. You have all kinds of land sharks and a lot of politicians who've come in the way and destroyed it. So the policy by itself is not wrong. It is to take that land and to rebuild it and rehabilitate them. It's not to do what Delhi tried to do, which is to take the land away and then move them out of the city. You can't solve for slums by moving them out because their livelihood is in the city.
Hello. Okay. I saw those statistics on the cities being centers of action in the time to come. My question is to do with seasonal migration, and particularly I'd like to cite from what I've observed in the construction sector, where you do have migrants based on the number of crops they have per year, and accordingly only the male members travel to the city. And I mean, right from the people who are supplying sand to masons, and there's this entire a dynamic of money being sent back to the village. To the extent, I know of a case from masons from UP who employ farm laborers to work on their lands there, while probably they're being paid 800 rupees a day for laying bricks. So how does this figure? And how does the MNREGA, I mean, for whatever it was, figure in this dynamic?
So what was your question associated with
migrant
construction? It's to do
with the statistics of... We're projecting the cities as being major centers, but I'm trying to talk about the rural-urban migration dynamic and what that does to how we plan for this.
So there is a... By the way, two-thirds of the growth of these cities is organic growth because people there are producing babies, right? And if you look at migration, a lot of migration, with the exception of Bombay and Delhi, most of the migration is interstate because of language. So migration in this country is very state-specific. But you're absolutely right. People do move. People move even for, till Narega came, people used to move even for farming. Now they do much less of it. But people will move for construction. That is true. So I don't think it changes the mix of the economy. Your point is, will people will find jobs, they'll move there. Because of Narega, actually in the last couple of years, two different things happened. I'm a supporter of Narega. Let me state that upfront, right? So you're hearing a positively biased point of view. I think what Narega did was two things. One was it increased the marginal cost of labor. So the exploitation that the traditional labor had got adjusted. Now in some cases, it went over the top. So if you are in Punjab or in Andhra Pradesh and you had labor which you would traditionally get for 100 bucks or 120 bucks, you are now getting it for 240. And the farmers there are now driving mechanization, which, by the way, is good, because why should India have so many people employed in agriculture? So I don't see anything wrong with that. But in the short term, there has been a cost increase in labor cost for high labor sectors, which are primarily vegetables and fruits. The second thing that Narega did was, because there was surplus cash in the system, and depending on which state, there was either 100% flow down to the workers or 40% flow down, so there was a certain amount of corruption. But because they had surplus cash, a lot of construction activity started. So the two reasons why you saw dampening down, not complete closure, but dampening down of non-seasonal migration was because there was local construction happening in our villages and because people were employed in Narega to a very large extent. The second order implication of this is actually education. When a worker moves, and usually the husband and the wife both will travel, right? Because it's a guy who doesn't own land or who does not have land on lease that migrates. When they move, their kids don't get educated. So one of the second order impacts of Narega in the last 5 to 6 years has been school enrollment in villages, because suddenly you are in that same place and you're not moving, and so your child is getting educated. So I think Narega is a social safety net, and it should continue to exist. But in the long term, if you look at the mix of our economy, unless we are able to do value addition to agriculture and create a different kind of job next to the village, and unless we are able to create two or three other economic engines of growth, you're going to see, why should 60% of India live where 50% of the GDP is? It doesn't make economic sense. People will go.
You mentioned about the municipal bonds, and you might be knowing Ahmedabad is one of the first cities to go for municipal bond. However, after 2005, there's no new issue of any municipal bond, and maybe it's attributed to the JNURM money being flushed into the cities, etc. Finance Commission report does mention that that could be one of the funding mechanisms. Do you really see it happening? Because none of our policies are pro municipal bonds from this point onwards. So do you have hope this could be revived?
One can only, as an Indian, you always hope, right? So so it won't happen because you and I want it, right? It'll happen under three conditions. One is cities have accounts. Most cities don't have accounts, right? Gujarat, parts of Tamil Nadu are few places where you actually have accounts. And second, these accounts need to be audited, right? So to me, the first condition is the market should be able to recognize creditworthiness or lack thereof of cities. The second thing is the market should be able to see what the use of these funds are. If it's for capex or if it's for opex, there's a huge difference. And third, if the bond market itself gets created, because of our very strong SLR and CRR ratio, the bond market in India is one of the weakest in the world, right? And so we don't have a deep enough bond market. If all of these conditions were to happen, the municipal bond market will happen. But it's also a double-edged sword. You could end up with a Detroit. You're just creating another way of siphoning off money. So it should not happen unless there are enough checks and balances. Otherwise, we're just going to have, Harshad Mehta from a different angle.
Transformation happens when there is a champion who leads, like in Singapore, Lee was there. And in our case, we have, as you mentioned, state government appointees, the commissioners who are there for 2 years, 3 years. So is the future, should India have like the city manager concept strengthened? Like what is the ideal way of having a robust management system of cities? What's your take on that?
So, to me, an ideal model would be a politician supported by a strong commissioner. And the politician has the courage and the vision to think 10 years, 20 years, and the commissioner has the capability and the execution focus to get stuff delivered, right? So it's not an either-or. But I struggle with the mere concept in India is so ceremonial that all they end up doing is to divide up the road budgets by the number of wards so that every ward manager makes enough money. Right? That's all they really do. But if you had somebody who bet his personal career to, I will transform Hyderabad or Ahmedabad, and he takes a 15, 20 year view of it, then you have somebody who's talking about the real stuff. Right? So that, in an ideal world, that's what should happen. And the question that I have is, if it's happening at the level of states, if it's happening at the level of villages, why are cities the only missing link? Because sarpanches are doing this, right? And your chief minister is in Delhi because he had a vision for Gujarat, right? And you have sarpanches who are becoming famous because they have visions for their own villages. So what is so unique about the poor city concept that it's left headless and leaderless. It should happen.
Hello, ma'am. I was actually trying to specifically relate your new vocabulary which you portray over here with the specific city of Mumbai. So, I mean, what I personally feel from my experiences, like when you call about a robust urban footprint, which should be urban blueprint, which should be created for any city or for any state. So specifically for Mumbai, there was a much bigger chance when the mill lands were obsolete and derelict, which we were talking about. And literally there was a plan created for a sector of mill land dedicated to affordable housing, developer, as well as for city amenities. And in spite of Charles Correa being in the authority body, in spite of really taking the pains and effort for creating every bit of, say, you like creating an economic plan which was linked to population as well as job, as you say here, in spite of prioritizing the developers as well as the people from the chawls as well as the mill workers who are jobless, along with the city amenities dedicated to the people from the city, in spite of having this link, as well as after that creating a master plan, as you say in the second point, in spite of doing this, everyone knows what is the state of Mumbai now. So the piecemeal affordable housing which was provided in every mill land, they were compiled together and they were thrown off outside the city. So there was job, there were people and there was land. But now there is no land and people are being thrown out more and more from the city. But the job is in the city. So how does this really, what is the solution for Mumbai basically? How is this really valid?
So if you go out of Mumbai and look at it, right? There is Island Mumbai, there are suburbs of Mumbai which go right up to Thane, and then there is the Uran area. And I don't know if you know, but the Bombay Port Trust is sitting on land which is equivalent to 1/3 of Island Mumbai, and it's completely underdeveloped. I don't know if you know that if Uran and South Bombay were to be connected by a conversation which has been going on for over 20, 22 years, you would suddenly have a huge block of land which is 4 times the size of Island Mumbai connected in a 15-minute ferry ride. And think of the development, the water development that you could do along the whole Arabian Sea. And on the other side, if you look at our suburbs, it's very fascinating that when the floods happened in Mumbai, and you must have been born at that time, South Bombay, which was built by the British, didn't flood. But the rest of Mumbai, which looks like Bareilly, you know, you almost wish for a Boston fire so that all of it goes away and then you rebuild it all again. So I don't think the mill lands going is the end of Mumbai. By the way, Mumbai is dying. Island Mumbai's GDP has shrunk every year for the last 5 years because people are voting with their feet. It's too expensive to live in, it's too painful to get to, and so all companies are moving their head offices out, and therefore people are moving out, and you will end up having really old age people living there, the old rich people living there, or you'll end up having mantralaya there. So I completely agree with what you're saying, which is one attempt did not work. But listen, we are in day 4 of our urbanization journey. We will have to make 5 or 6 attempts like this. And tell me when the 10th one doesn't work. Then I'll cry with you. But till the 10th attempt, you know, let's go for it. That's the only hope we have.
Creation of 100 smart cities, and these include retrofitting of old ones and creation of new ones. So what could be the financial instruments for funding of the new cities, like apart from PPP, because like municipal bonds won't be applicable in this case, if like in the case of Andhra Pradesh's new capital. So what could be the financial instruments for the same, for funding?
So I think there are two different questions. One is the government has no clue what to do with the 100 smart cities, right? For the last 1 year, they've been trying to define what smart means. So let's keep that aside. I think the tools will be the ones that we discuss. There isn't anything else. These are the only tools that work. In the case of Amravati, a significant amount should actually be a grant, right? The rest of it, there is nothing there to grow. So I don't think the tools differ. And smart is just a buzzword, right? In the real world of urbanization, it has already been replaced by resilient city. Smart was 2 years old, but for some reason we've hooked on to a buzzword and we've got lost in the semantics of it. But the government has no clue what to do with smart.
My question is regarding devolution of power to cities. So, what do you think would be actually a trigger which would let that lead to
devolution? I wish I knew. I don't know what the trigger is.
Because this comes again and again, you know, devolution of power. But who would do it? And do you see it happening in like next 5, 10, 15 years? Like,
maybe Amit Shah will be the trigger. No, seriously. If he is building a BJP cadre, right? What will he do with that cadre, right? He'll have to give them some projects to do. And I think, or maybe Rahul Gandhi will be the trigger if he can come back to this country. So I don't know. One trigger would be that. And either the trigger would be because now he's collected 10 million BJP youth workers and he has to put them to do something, right? Or the trigger will be AAP and Kejriwal are psyching them and saying city by city we will lose to the local Kejriwal. It's a political trigger, right? I don't know.
My question was with regard to affordable housing. So, I mean, you said that one of the main, historically, for affordable housing, we've had a lot of industry coming in, like the mill housing, and 40-ish years ago, there was a lot of work done by Gujarat Housing Board and by LIC in this city, which built a lot of housing for its employees. But what I'm really thinking is, since that model seems to have died off in today's times, is there a legislative or some other kind of financial mechanism which can again incentivize companies or government to create some kind of rental affordable housing? Because the model so far, even for slum redevelopment, has been purchase. Like even the BSUP projects, even the relatively good ones which are still close to the center of the city, are still predicated on the people being given houses and then those houses staying there until they can afford to buy them. So, I mean, is there is a mechanism?
Scheme. There is a scheme, the Rajiv Gandhi Awas Yojana, and it was revisited 2 or 3 years ago, and they increased the FAR, and they've created a guarantee fund and a whole bunch of things. I think the real challenge for the government is they haven't brought in two elements, and then there's an operational issue. One, they haven't been able to help them think through where they will give them the land. The second is they haven't been able to get into their heads the whole point about rental rather than selling. And the moment they don't do that, and the moment they make it about a market-based model, the reality of the market is, if you look at our real estate players, they're all so busy building middle-class homes and rich homes. And there are only these many contractors in this country, and there are only these many plumbers in this country, that EWS always gets the short shift. So we will now perhaps have a private equity-driven different kind of model, like Jana Housing is starting. There's something here in Gujarat which was funded by a Soros fund who are trying to do some stuff. But I think till the mainstream construction guys come in, it's going to be difficult to build it at scale. And they are not coming in because they look at the relative return on putting their contractor on building a middle-class home versus an EWS and say, I have scarcity there, why should I waste my time here? So I think till the rental model comes in, I think this is something that the government will have to do. It can't be left to the market.
Hi. My question is, I think you talked about two things. One is the shape of the city, the other is affordability. And there is a lot of these is governed by also black money. There is influence of black money and where to park the black money. And that governs a lot of times the shape of the city or and affordability. So how do you see role of black money and if there is any mechanism of controlling that, controlling its influence on the city?
So what's the link you see between black money and shape of the city?
Basically, those are your real estate and the shape of and the land becomes kind of avenues to park black money a lot of times, and then a lot of plans, city plans also get influenced by that, and that also kind of influences affordability, also availability of housing for people. So you're saying
that land use is influenced by rich landowners, and a lot of them are politicians with black money.
Yes.
Agreed.
So do you see that there is any kind of influence of that kind of, you know?
you can, so for example, if you look at Bombay, right? Bombay was milked in the last 10 years systematically, at least South Bombay. But this new government, and it has a lot of slaughter-related issues, but at least on land, it seems to be talking about revisiting something as simple as FSI. And so suddenly, at least in the Bombay conversation, the whole conversation is about much more land is going to, much more construction is going to be available. And maybe it's because the politicians have milked Bombay so much that there's nothing left to milk. Or maybe it's the start of a different conversation. But the simplest logic for it, I mean, if the government wants to do it, they can, right? The problem is, and maybe that's why it's good that you have a whole new regime who has come in. One tragedy of it could be they have to make black money themselves. The other one could be they don't have vested interests. But if you look at the old regime, it was so vested in South Bombay that they wouldn't allow the Uran link, they wouldn't allow FAR to be differentiated. There was a standard FAR, and the exception was given building by building. Right? So I think it's one of the toughest political decisions. On the other hand, it's a stroke of pen decision because the logic for it is very clear. Right? The issue is which politician has the courage and the support of his party to sign it. It's just a question of a single signature. There's nothing dramatic in it to be able to differentiate your FSI.
Thank you so much, Ireena Vittal, for sharing your thoughts with us. Looking at this presentation and the earlier report on urbanization, it seems that a lot of these steps have been thought through. I think it's just a matter of when somebody pulls that trigger to start the process, and it may be just like you're saying, a stroke of pen decision. In any case, thank you so much. It was very insightful, and thank you all for attending. Have a good night.